Egypt. This is indeed a pleasure for me to be here. The Egyptian hospitality is absolutely fantastic, and the way that I have been received and the organization for me here while I'm here is absolutely staggering. So I'm very happy to be here, and I think I feel a little humble. When I was 30 years, 40 years ago, when I was a young man, I visited the pyramids here at Giza for the first time and found this was absolutely incredible. And now I'm back here and standing in the shadow of the 5,000 years of knowledge and trying to advance science, and I think that this is absolutely fantastic. So I really feel privileged to be here. So what I would like to talk to you about today is a pretty controversial issue. It has been a lot of publications, there's been a lot of talks about it, and I actually think that a lot of people are not quite sure what the underlying biological mechanisms are and what they actually have of implications for the whole issue on how progesterone is regulated in the follicular phase and the importance, especially for US clinicians, the importance of the late follicular phase rise in determining whether that woman in that particular cycle has a chance of becoming pregnant. I can already now state that I probably don't think that this is valid or worthwhile doing in the clinic, but we'll have discussions on that while we go on. I'm unable to show pictures of beautiful flowers and very nice summer, but what we have at the moment is what we call ice flowers in the country where I come from. So this is ice flowers, and this is because it's absolutely cold. When I left Copenhagen, we had ice on the sea. It was so thick that people could walk on it. But this is just to disclose my whatever I have to disclose, and I'm giving a lot of talks, and I also received some honorarium for it. We are now getting to the point where the sun is slowly coming back. So we also worship the sun a lot in our country, and I think it's even more important for us than it is for you, because it disappears during winter. But now it's coming, and it's beautiful. So my take-home message for you today is that indeed, if you look generally, retrospectively, then the late follicular phase progesterone level appear to reflect the risk of reduced pregnancy outcome in some patient categories. I will limit this, there's not a lot of patients where this actually accounts for, but maybe there is something. If we look at how progesterone is synthesized in the follicular phase of the menstrual cycle, it do turn out that LH-like activity, LH or HCG, is the main driver. But LH does not work on its own. LH only works in conjunction with FSH, so it's not simple, because FSH induces LH receptor expression, and without any receptors, LH does not work. And I would like to advance a new hypothesis which I have conceived on why we may have a detrimental effect of late follicular phase progesterone. So this is the end of the talk. I would like to call your attention to the fact that if you're looking at the late follicular phase progesterone rise and correlating that to pregnancy outcome, you're basically associating two events which have 8 days in between. So the first is when you measure progesterone at the late follicular phase, and then you're looking at implantation, which is the mid-luteal phase. Of course, any event which you do in between may also have a subsequent effect on how you establish pregnancy. So just taking one and compared to two, then you disregard what happens in between. And I think that this is a mistake you make, because there's a lot of stuff going on, especially the HCG trigger, which indeed induces or introduces enormous amounts of HCG and progesterone. And this is where the whole thing is buried. So when you do that, you have to be aware of it. So there's been a lot of studies around on the late follicular phase progesterone rise over the years, but it basically only started when the IV group with Ernesto Bosch published this study in 2010, where they looked retrospectively at more than 4,000 cycles, and looked at the chance of pregnancy, as you see on the left-hand side, in relation to the late follicular phase progesterone rise. And you can see that when you exceed 1.5 nanograms per mil, the pregnancy rate goes from around 30 to around 20. And indeed, this has been repeated in many other studies. If you look at the number of patients which are in the group with progesterone rise about 1.5, this is perhaps 6% of the total patient population. And if you look at Ernesto's data, he actually sees that there's a highly significant association to the amount of FSH administered, to the number of oocytes, and also to the number to the estradiol level on the day of HCT. This will turn out to be also of significance. So it's not only progesterone, but also the fact that you have used a lot of FSH and you have a high estradiol level. The guys from Greek are extremely good at making meta-analysis, and they made a beautiful meta-analysis in human reproduction update a few years ago, where they again confirmed that if you have a late follicular phase progesterone rise, overall your pregnancy rate will be reduced. If they looked at the frozen salt cycles, there were no effect of the high progesterone rise. So their conclusion was that the embryos are okay. This is an adverse effect to the endometrium. And this was basically also what a Chinese study concluded, where you had more than 10,000 cycles. It's pretty amazing how the Chinese nowadays are capable of putting out studies where they have staggering numbers of cycles in there. But again, you see that when you get above 1.5 nanograms, the fresh cycle appears to have a reduced pregnancy rate, whereas the frozen salt actually do the opposite, if anything. But at least it's not affected. So again, a convincing evidence that the late follicular phase progesterone rise have an effect. So we did another study in 2011 where we also associated the progesterone rise with the pregnancy outcome. And this was the Nordi LH study. So half of the patients received recombinant LH from Sirona and the other half did not. And we were unable to see any effect. And as you can see, what we found was that the number of oocytes, on the other hand, was highly significant associated to the circulating levels of progesterone, as was the number of follicles. We did not see any effect on FSH consumption. But as you can see that I've just inserted a line, the blood sample in this particular study was obtained on the day of HCT administration in the evening. In the evening will turn out to be of importance. I'd like to come back to that later. But you can see here, this is a fairly big number of patients, 475 altogether, and we could see absolutely no effect of progesterone. If anything, it goes a little up with higher levels of progesterone. And it didn't matter at all whether LH was added or not. So this was then different from the first studies. So why on earth does this happen? We went on and did an additional study, which was published in Fertility and Sterility 2013, where we, in collaboration with MSD, we evaluated all their clinical trials on Elonda and the control arm. So not the arm where you had used Elonda, but the control arm where you used HCT. And they had all these six different prospective randomized studies in order to get Elonda approved. So we looked at the control arm in all these studies. And basically, this means that you can see on top, the first level, we are now having more than 1,800 cycles to compare with. And we actually reached a number of 157 where the late follicular phase progesterone rise was about 1.5. So now we have a sizable study, randomized prospective, and everything was there. And you can see that, again, it comes up that those who have high levels of progesterone have significantly increased levels of estradiol, high number of oocytes, high number of embryos, and good quality embryos, and so on. So this is what we would expect, that those with high levels of progesterone reflect a high responder group. We looked at the pregnancy rate, overall pregnancy rate in this group. And you can see there's different odds ratios at the bottom. It again do come up that if you have the raised progesterone level, your overall chance of pregnancy is reduced. But the interesting part on this study is that numbers are now so big that we can start to stratify for the number of oocytes which has been retrieved. So here you can see we have stratified those 157 patients in three groups, 1 to 5 oocytes collected, 16 to 18, and above 18. So low response, normal response, and high response. And the really interesting part here is to see that in those where we have a normal and low response, indeed it do turn out that the high progesterone levels predict a lower pregnancy. But if you have a lot of follicles, it reverses. If anything, it may be said it's not statistically significant different, but if anything, those with a lot of follicles has a higher chance of becoming pregnant. So now we're coming into trouble because the meta-analysis suggested that the embryos were okay, but the endometrium was not. But the endometrium just looks at what progesterone is coming in circulation and are unaware of how many follicles has produced the progesterone. So if this is the case, then it's not the endometrium either. So we are left with, it's not the embryos, it's not the endometrium. So what are we going to look for? Well, there was another study from Israel where they looked at the progesterone to follicle index. So they said that the concentration of progesterone divided by the number of follicles, how does this predict pregnancy? And then they divided it and they said the lowest 10%, the group with the lowest index looked at the pregnancy rate, and as you can see on the left hand side, there was a pretty straight line downwards. So the more progesterone you produce per follicle, the lower the chance of pregnancy. Of course, this was looking at it in a different way. And I think actually this comes out as one of the things we can look at. So as I said to you, it's not the embryo, it's not the endometrium. But these patients who do not produce that many oocytes, 1 to 5, these are probably not good patients a priori. If you put a lot of FSH on them and they produce just a few lousy follicles, they do not become pregnant. And they may not have done that anyway, because they don't produce a lot of oocytes. So maybe this is just a pre-selection of a group of patients which do not have the same chances. Or perhaps there is another explanation which we haven't thought of. And I think I'm probably trying to put the two last statements together and say this is probably where the truth lays. But before we go there, you will need to know a little bit about how progesterone synthesis is actually regulated in the follicular phase of the menstrual cycle. Here you have on the upper left-hand corner cholesterol, and in the lower-hand corner you have estradiol. In between you have pregnenolone, 17-hydroxypregnenolone, DHEA on the first row, and the second row you have progesterone, 17-hydroxyprogesterone, and androstenediol. So we actually have two alternative pathways. Why on earth would nature ever consider to put in two pathways if we only need estradiol? Well, this is not the case in women. In women, we have two end products. We have estradiol and progesterone. And the way this comes out is that cholesterol is converted to pregnenolone, and then you can have the first row, which is the delta-5 pathway, or you can be converted through the red line, which is 3-beta-HSD, 3-beta-hydroxy, steroid dehydrogenase, and then converted to progesterone or 17-hydroxyprogesterone. But the human insight that converts 17-hydroxypregnenolone or 17-hydroxyprogesterone to the next level does not undertake the lower the reaction. So the 17-hydroxyprogesterone conversion to androstenediol does not happen in the human brain. And therefore, progesterone and 17-hydroxyprogesterone are terminal products. And therefore, the two pathways make sense. You use the upper one to produce estradiol. The lower one is to produce progesterone. I just want to show you a picture which we have made in our laboratory showing where these enzymes are basically located. And the outer, the big one, is the CYP17. This is the enzyme producing antigens, converting pregnenolone to DHEA or 17 hydroxy to androstenedione. And as you can see, this is exclusively located in CICA cells. And this is important to understand that this conversion do not take place in the follicle, but only outside. The insert is showing the aromatase gene, which is the enzyme converting antigens to estradiol, and this is exclusively located in the granulosa cells. So this is basically just demonstrating the two-cell tumor-trophic concept, but it doesn't become more clear than this, I think. So, if progesterone indeed is a terminal product, we would expect it to be accumulated, because then it should not be converted. How does this then come up? If you look at these data from Alan Snyder's group in New York some years ago, they looked at the interfollicular concentration in natural menstrual cycles and related that to follicular diameter and the day of the cycle. And you can see, please notice that the y-axis is logarithmic, so we have actually extremely high concentrations of progesterone on the left-hand side. And you can see the diameter is very significantly associated to the concentration of progesterone. So the more progesterone that is produced is not converted to estradiol. And you can see the day of predicted ovulation, we actually end up by something by 5,000 nanograms of progesterone per mil. So this is extremely high concentration, and it is not converted. If you look at how this is then regulated in the menstrual cycle, is it FSH or LH that is the main producer of progesterone? We actually have some studies from Steve Hillier's group, which he did in the early 90s when he was still at Imperial College, and they actually do come out very clearly. If you look at the upper left-hand panel, you can see that this is progesterone. The closed circles is LH, the open one is FSH. So if you take granulosa cells from follicles in the second half of the follicular phase, but before having the mid-cycle surge, their capacity to produce progesterone is very high and most pronounced affected by LH. So you can see that LH is stimulating progesterone a lot more than FSH. So how does this come out if you use it in a clinical setting in connection with IVF? There's a study from one of my colleagues in my hospital, Anders Mygrup Andersen, who was very showing this very nicely. So he did a study where he kept FSH administration absolutely constant. This is agonist, this is agonist patients, so they are not antagonist cycles. And then he tested out the concentration of HCG. He created four groups. One group that did not receive any HCG with the recombinant FSH, one that received 50 units per day, 150 units per day. So the endocrinology of this study is very interesting. If you look at the middle panel on the right-hand side, you can see FSH is absolutely similar in all these four groups, which we would expect. After 4 or 5 days, we reach a steady state level of around 12 units per liter. If you look at LH, this is the lower right-hand corner, you can see we have agonist down-regulated, it comes down to 2, it's not a lot. So HCG is the upper left-hand panel. You can see 0, of course, 0 HCG. If you put in 50, your steady-state concentration is 3. If you put in 100, it's 6. If you put in 150, it's 11. So any difference in the endocrinology is related to HCG. But then look at the steroids. The middle panel on the left-hand side is androstenedione. You can actually see that if you administer 150 units of HCG daily, you more than double the concentration of androstenedione. The lower left-hand is estradiol. The same thing here. You really boost estradiol and also progesterone. If this is the upper right-hand corner, you can see progesterone is very much influenced by the addition of HCG. So this is important to understand that HCG drives progesterone. They also looked at 17-hydroxy progesterone, but they didn't publish that in the same paper. But if you look at the concentrations of 17-hydroxy progesterone in these women, these are the blue bars. The green, too gray and black, is the data I already showed you. But you can see that 17 hydroxy progesterone is now 4-5 times higher than progesterone. And what does 17 hydroxy progesterone do? It basically don't, but you can see we're talking about 15 nanomolar in the hydroxy. So this comes in on top of whatever progesterone is being produced. And then, as I said to you, the Danish study, the study that I was the first author on, where we looked at the Nordic LA study and looked at it and found absolutely no association to progesterone. What happened? Well, as you saw, the blood sample was collected in the evening. Does that matter? It does. It does indeed matter when you collect the blood sample. As you will see here on the right-hand side, you can see this is the urine variation of progesterone in 20 women measured every second hour. So you can see that if you measure it in the evening, it's below 2, but if you measure it early in the morning, it's between 3 and 4. So of course, there is a huge variation. So this came out in 2011, and there's just a new study which has been released in 2018, where they looked at cortisol and progesterone. You all know cortisol is very much influenced on when you take the blood sample. But the blue one, which is progesterone, is almost as bad. So it all depends on when you take the blood sample. And you can see that the overall mean is 100% for the day. So if you take it in the evening, maybe 50%. If you take it early in the morning, maybe 150%. So you need to know when you take it in order to evaluate it. And what happened to our study was probably that the blood sample was taken in the evening and none of the patients had any elevated progesterone. But this, we just didn't know that at this time. If you look at the amount of FSH administered, it do correlate with the amount of progesterone being produced. So I've just convinced you that LH is driving this. So what is FSH? FSH is also in there. Let's have a look. This is my fault. I messed this up. I have to try and see if we can. Yes, this is just to show you how it looks in my country for the time being. All the white you see in the picture is actually snow. Let's see what FSH is doing to the granulosa cells in order for this progesterone rise or this progesterone production to come about. If we look at it, if we take human granulosa cells from follicles before the mid-cycle, so to culture them, stimulate them with A, androstenedione plus HCG, androstenedione plus FSH, or the whole thing together, it actually do come out very clearly that FSH induce LH receptor depression. So unless we have LH receptors, we do not have any response from LH. So FSH is doing that. Okay. If we look at LH, then it comes out that the, this is a little technical, but the association, the affinity constant of the LH receptor means that we hardly need any LH in there. Then we have a maximal stimulation of the receptor. So it doesn't matter whether LH is 1 or 5 units, we have maximal stimulation of the receptors which are in there. But if you look at the receptor density, so this is now an FSH-induced response. This heavily depends on how much progesterone they put out. So this is a study from Mary Eskerville's lab in the States some years ago, where they took a Leydig cell line, and then they could control the number of LH receptors which were expressed in these cells. And then they just tested it with a constant level of HCG. And what you see, you don't need to go into the other, but the upper right-hand corner is progesterone output by these cells in relation to the number of LH receptors being expressed. And you can see that there's an absolutely close association. The more LH receptors, the more progesterone. So it may not be LH concentration, but LH receptor density, which is important. We basically just confirmed that in the study in JCM 2012, if you look at the upper row, you can can see LH receptor expression in granulosa cells from small axon follicles. This is all human. Those which have been retrieved from women with IBM, preoperatory before the mid-cycle surgery, then mature granulosa cell. And you can see that the preoperatory follicle expressed a huge amount of LH receptor, whereas FSH receptor is actually going down. So again, showing that the LH receptor density is important for having CYP19, the aromatase, up. So what happens when you do various stimulations? During the natural menstrual cycle, you all know we have a peak of FSH in the early, in the first half of the cycle, we have a recruitment and then it decreases. But when you do IVF, we maintain FSH levels artificially high. So we do whatever we can to induce LH receptor expression on these granulosa cells because we keep FSH high. So, ovarian stimulation introduces superphysiological levels of FSH and we have a high LH receptor production. So even small concentration variants of LH in the late follicular phase will affect progesterone. But the granulosa cells are not exposed to very high levels of LH in the follicular phase, but only when we come to ovulation induction. And these are data which we are preparing in collaboration with Dr. Lan from Vietnam. And as you can see on the upper right-hand corner, you can see that the levels of progesterone compared to the natural cycle in the luteal phase, in the early luteal phase, is extremely high. Now we're talking about 60 nanograms per mil instead of 1.5, and it remains extremely high for some days, and then only at day 6 it starts to decline. The natural cycle is in there for comparison. Of course, we have a massive stimulation of progesterone in the early luteal phase. So, the bonus trigger of HCG is part of determining the mid-cycle, the progesterone peak. The density of LH receptor expression is there. So it may be that the high follicular phase progesterone rise is likely to reflect LH receptor expression and predict a profound response to the bonus trigger. So my hypothesis now is that the magnitude of the early luteal phase rise in progesterone, this is where you have, may have an advancement of the endometrium, and this may cause a reduced implantation rather than the 1.5 that you see at the end of the follicular phase. So, I think that if you look at the progesterone rise in the late follicular phase in cases where you have few follicles, so this means that just a few follicles is capable of producing so much progesterone that it comes about 1.5. But this just means that they are extremely sensitive to HCG. So when you come around with the bonus trigger, you really shoot off progesterone in the early luteal phase, and this is where the damage happens. So if this is the case, then we would expect that the late follicular phase progesterone concentration was associated to what we see when we take out the oocytes, because in between is the mid-cycle. So we have, I've done a lot of studies together with Peter Meiden, where we looked at the introduction of the agonist trigger. And here you can see that we have associated the concentration of progesterone on the day of ovulation induction and on the day of egg retrieval. And you can see that this comes out with the Spearman correlation coefficient of 0.7. So this is highly, highly significant associated. So if you have a high level at the end of the follicular phase, induce ovulation, you have a very high concentration right thereafter, which again shows that you have a shooting up when you give the HCG trigger. If we look at the agonist trigger arm in this study, of course the agonist trigger is just producing a small physiological peak of LH, and therefore we see a much lower slope, but still a very significant association, but we haven't pressed the trigger as much because there's not the same amount of LH activity. So here you see the two groups, the HCG trigger and the DNA trigger, and you can see the slope is much higher with the HCG. We are pushing this a lot harder. So this makes sense. If we look at it and then say, if we try to relate this to the number of follicles, then you will be able to, and then we have taken the level of progesterone at oocyte retrieval compared to the level of progesterone at adoption, you can see that there's no difference. But if we do it per follicle, then you can see that there's a huge significant association. So we use a lot, we have a lot higher progesterone and a lot higher FSH consumption per follicle if we just have a few, which means that we have whipped these few follicles a lot more when there's just a few of them, because we have seen a lot more FSH, they have a lot higher LH receptor induction. So this is probably what we see. So in case of elevated progesterone and clinical consequences, the high significant association on progesterone on the day of ovulation induction and OPU justifies that you may not need to measure it on the day of ovulation induction. You can do it on the day of OPU. And this is now what clinics, if they do it in America, this is what they do, because now you have a sizable concentration of progesterone which you can determine a lot more precisely. So people do not do it at the end of the follicular phase and say, okay, but we can do it 24 or 36 hours later. But does it matter? Does it matter? Is it really so that if we put the fresh embryos back, if you have had an elevated progesterone rise and say, our freezing program is absolutely beautiful. Just put them in the tank, they come back, and they have a frozen cycle, and then they have a chance to become pregnant. Of course, we shouldn't do that unless they have a better chance of becoming pregnant. Otherwise, we may as well just put it back in the fresh cycle. And I think I'll end up by showing you that there's now just been two papers in 2018 published in New England Journal of Medicine. They are enormous. This one is from China, 2,157. The other one is from Vietnam, from Lan's group. And you can see the pregnancy rates from fresh and frozen. They're absolutely similar. So people do not gain anything from putting all the embryos in the tank and putting it back in. You don't see a difference. So if you should consider this, I think that you should only consider this for patients where you get very few oocytes and where you've been putting in a heck of a lot of FSH, and then you come out and say, well, she's producing 3-5 oocytes and she has a raised progesterone, then maybe consider this. But this will be less than 1% of your patient population, and basically, I don't think it's justified to measure progesterone. So, in conclusion, and I have deliberately included a picture from last year I was here, and again, I really do would like to acknowledge as much as possible that it is absolutely fantastic to stand here in the shadow of the pyramids. But my conclusion is that progesterone secretion is mainly stimulated by the LH sensitivity. It's a final product, it's not converted any further, it's there, it has a physiological function, that's a different lecture. FSH is very important in securing LH receptor expression, and this goes hand in hand with progesterone. But my proposal is that follicles with inappropriate high LH receptor expression, mainly due to high FSH exposure in the follicular phase, they hyper-respond to the mid-cycle receptors. Then you have a massive increase of progesterone in the early luteal phase, and if you have any advantage of the intervention, this is where this happens. I think, as I said, clinically, this is not too important, and I think that maybe in a few years' time, we won't discuss this matter too much anymore. This is the laboratory that I represent.